Students, today we will start the first chapter of economics, that is story of village Palampur. Do you know where is Palampur? Palampur is the imaginary name which is given to all types of villages which are in India where the cultivation processes are done. This is the introductory page. It is telling that the main occupation of the people who are living in Palampur, the main activity is farming, but some of the people are also engaged in the other economic activities like small scale manufacturing, dairy, transport and many more activities. These production activities need various types of resources like natural resources, man-made resources, human effort, money, etc. Palampur is well connected with neighboring village and town. Well connected means the transportation system is better and the Palampur is connected with the small town, that is Raiganj, and it is also connected to the big cities like Shahpur. These are the names of the places, of the imaginary names which are given to these places. And due to the better transportation system, Palampur is well connected to the nearby towns and cities. In the Palampur, it has about 450 families belonging to several different castes. This village has about 450 families belonging to several different castes. The upper caste families own the majority of the land in the village. Their houses, some of them quite large, are made up of brick with cement plastering. The SEs comprising 1/3 of the population and live in one corner of the village and in much smaller houses, some of which are of mud and straw. It means, after studying this paragraph, we come to know that there are two types of people living in the villages. Some are big farmers, means they are rich, and many are small farmers, means about 450 families living in Palampur, but among 450 families, very less people are rich and more number of people are poor. They don't have the proper houses to live, means the population of poor family is more. In Palampur, Palampur means all types of villages which are in India. So, all the villages which are in India are having better electricity power supply. So, due to that, the farmers can use the irrigation system. They can use the electricity for the better irrigation system. They can also use for running small businesses. Palampur has two primary schools and one high school. That means our government is doing better for the education, in the education field also. The government is putting more importance, giving more importance to the education also. There is a primary health center run by the government and one private dispensary where the sick are treated. Government is also putting stress on improving the better medical facilities by establishing the primary healthcare centers in every village. Now, as we had already seen, that most of the people in the villages are engaged in the production activities, production of goods and services. So there are four major requirements for the production of goods and services. The first one is land, second is labor, third is physical capital. First of all, we will see the first category, that is physical capital. There are two types of physical capital. One is your fixed capital. Another is your working capital. There are two types of capital. One is fixed capital, another is your working capital. What are fixed capitals? Examples are written in front of you, like tools, machinery, buildings. These all are fixed capital, examples of the fixed capital. So what are fixed capital? The fixed capitals are those capitals, those investments in the production processes which are being used for longer duration, for the longer period of time. Like once they are purchased and they can be used for more than one production processes, that is known as fixed capital. Like we are studying agriculture about a village. So the farmers are purchasing tractors, tools, equipments. They all are the part of the fixed capital. Second, some examples are also given of the working capital. Working capital are those capitals which are used for a short period of time. That means these capitals or these type of investment can be used once during a production process. It is getting used up during the production process, like in the agriculture, fertilizers, seeds, weedicides, pesticides, cash, these all are labor wages. These all are the examples of the working capital. Means once they are being used in the production process, they can't be used in the other production processes. For a short period of time, it can be used. So there are two types of physical capital, working capital and fixed capital. Second is, let us switch over to the next category, that is land, which is the very foremost requirement in the production processes. In the production processes, as we had already read that there are four different types of production, factors of the production. Every production is organized by combining land, labor, physical capital and human capital. Means four different types of factors are required during the production processes. So the very first one is land is fixed. First factor of production is land, and we know that land is fixed. So we can't increase the size of the land. Like India is having 3.28 million square kilometer of area. Among this area, very few part of the land is being used for the cultivation purpose. And it is fixed. We can't increase it. So farming is the main production activity in Palanpur. 75% of the people who are working as dependent on family for their livelihood. They could be farmers or farm laborers. There is a basic constraint in raising from the production. Land area under cultivation is practically fixed. Since 1960 in Palanpur, there has been no expansion in the land area under cultivation. Means I am telling you from the beginning itself, land is fixed. We can't increase the cultivation area. As much we got, we have to do the production. We have to grow the crop from that particular area. By then, some of the wastelands in the village had been converted to cultivable land. But then also, some of the wastelands are there which are being utilized by the farmers to increase the area of cultivation. There exists no further scope for increased farm production by bringing now new land under cultivation. No further scope to increase production means now nothing is there to increase the production. Land is fixed, and from the fixed land, from the fixed area of the land, we have to increase the production. We will see after a few minutes how we can increase the production from the fixed area of the land. This is also one of the important points to be remembered, that the standard unit of measuring land is hectare. Is there a way one can grow more crops from the same land? Is there any way? Yes, it is there. It is there. The first one is by growing multiple crops on the same piece of land at the same time. That means multi-cropping method. Second is crop rotation. In different seasons, the crop rotation farmers can follow, and that can be used by, this practice can be used by the farmers to increase the production from the same piece of land. Means from in the same, on the same piece of land, different types of crops are can be grown one after the another in different seasons. That is known as crop rotation. These two methods are there by which we can increase the production. In this paragraph, as it is written in red color, it is given about the crop rotation during the Kharif season and Rabi season. Some examples are also given here, like Kharif crops are there. After that, Rabi crops are grown after cultivating the Kharif, harvesting the Kharif crops. Kharif, Rabi crops are grown. So, like this, we understood how the crop rotation maintains the fertility of the land, and it also increases the production from the same piece of land. Multiple cropping and crop rotation method. There is one more method by which the production can be increased. Which one is that? That is by adopting the modern farming methods. India has also done. In 1960s, since in 1960s, India became successful in getting independent in the availability of the food grains. Before 1960s, India was importing food grains from the foreign countries to make available for such a large population. But in 1960s, the production was increased, and due to increase in the production processes, due to increase in the production yield, India stopped importing the food grains from the other countries. How it is possible? It is possible only by the implementation of the modern farming methods, like by using HYV seeds, insecticide, weedicide, pesticides, by using chemical fertilizers. Farmers are able to increase the production, and this was known as Green Revolution. It was implemented first of all on the wheat. And after the increase in the production of wheat, it was also implemented on the other grains like rice, pulses and other grains also. Farmers of Punjab, Haryana and Western Uttar Pradesh were the first to try out the modern farming methods in India. The farmers in these regions set up tube wells for irrigation. and made use of HYV seeds, chemical fertilizers and pesticides in farming. Some of them bought farm machineries like tractors and threshers, which made plowing and harvesting faster. They were rewarded with high yields of wheat. So, till now we had learned that there are three ways by which we can increase the production from the same piece of land. One is multi-cropping. Multiple crops can be grown on the same piece of land. Second is crop rotation. Different types of crops can be grown on, can be cultivated in on same land in different seasons. Third is by using modern farming methods. Will the land sustain? Farmers adopted using the various methods of modern farming methods, but will the land sustain after using such a kind of chemicals, chemical fertilizers, weedicide, pesticides? Obviously not. So here are some of the drawbacks, some of the disadvantages of modern farming methods. Like, as we know, in modern farming methods, HYV seeds are used. HYV seeds need more irrigation as compared to the traditional seeds. So HYV seeds needs more water, more irrigation. So what the farmers are doing? Farmers are irrigating more. And for that, they are using fresh waters. Fresh underground water. So because of that, the water level, underground water level decreases. Not only that, the chemical fertilizers, the excessive use of chemical fertilizer decreases the fertility of the soil. It harms the bacteria which are helpful in maintaining the in the composition process, in maintaining the fertility of the soil. It harms that bacteria. Sometimes we know that some of the chemicals get dissolved in water. Chemical fertilizer provide minerals which dissolve in water and are immediately available to plants, but these may not be retained in the soil for long. They may escape from the soil and pollute the groundwater. They get mixed up with the groundwater as well as rivers and lakes. Chemical fertilizers can also kill bacteria and other microorganisms, which helps and maintains the fertility of the soil. These all are the drawbacks or disadvantages of the modern farming methods. Means, we have to improve the quality of our cultivation. We should adopt the modern farming methods, but in a very smart way, so that it should not harm the environment as well as the soil's fertility. How is land distributed between the farmers of the Palampur? We had already studied that most of the villagers, or most of the people in the villages, are practicing agriculture. So some of the people are having the larger pieces of land. Some of the families are having larger pieces of land. That means if total 450 families are living in a village, among that 150 families are there which are landless. They don't have their own land for the cultivation. Some of the families, very few families, are having land, but they are very small, and it's very hard for them to fulfill the needs and the requirements of the grains for their family. So, what is the gist of this paragraph? We found that most of the families in this village, or in every village, carries some of the families which are having larger pieces of the land. So these larger pieces of land, from these larger pieces of land, they get more production, higher production. And this production, mainly they used to sell it in the open market, in the market, and in return they are getting huge profit. So there are two types of farmers living in Palampur or every village. One is big farmers, another is your small farmers. To the big farmers and small farmers, who will provide labors? Who will provide labors? After land, labor is the most necessary factor for the production. Farming requires a great deal of hard work. Means, just now we had discussed about the small farmers and the big farmers. We found that in a village, variety of farmers are living. Some are big, some are small farmers. Some are having bigger pieces of the land, they are rich farmers. And some are having smaller pieces of land, they are small farmers. Some are landless, those who don't have their own land. So they used to work on the land of others, rich farmers. So related to that only, I am asking, who will provide the labor? So in a small farmer's family, during the cultivation process, the whole family is working as a labor on their own field. Clear? But in medium and large farmers, they used to hire the laborers. Means they are not doing their work by themselves. They used to take the work from the hired laborers to work on their fields. This is the condition of the laborers. The capital needed in farming. The capital needed in farming. From where the small farmers are arranging their capital, means they are engaged in doing the farming, they are engaged in doing cultivation processes, but from where they are arranging their capital? They used to arrange their capital by borrowing the money, by taking loan. Means they have to purchase the seeds, fertilizers, weedicide, pesticide. So from where they will arrange all these things? They have to irrigate their fields. From where they will arrange? They will borrow money to arrange for their capital. This is the condition of the small farmers. They borrow from the large farmers or the village money lenders or the traders who supply various inputs for cultivation. The rate of interest on such loans is very high. They are put to get distress to repay the loan. But what about the big farmers? Means what? Not only big farmers. From where the big farmers arrange their capital? From where the big farmers arrange their capital? They used to arrange their capital by themselves. They are having surplus of saving and they utilize their saving. They utilize their savings by themselves as a capital. Now, what the surplus they are doing? Sale of surplus of the farm products. What is surplus? The excess produce. What the small farmers are doing of their surplus? Small farmers are not having that much production from their land because they are having small pieces of land. So they are keeping the necessary grains or required grains. They are storing it for the whole year, and excess produce, surplus, they are selling it in the market, and they use that money for returning loan to the big farmers or the money lenders. But what about big farmers? They are having larger pieces of land, so they are having more production also. So what they are doing? The required amount, the required quantity, they are storing it at their home and surplus they are selling it in the market. Traders at the market buy the wheat and sell it further to the shopkeepers in the towns and the cities. Other large and medium farmers sell the surplus farm products. A part of earning is saved and kept for buying capital for the next season. This is the condition of the big farmers or the rich farmers. Thus, they are able to arrange for the capital for farming from their own savings. Some farmers might also use the savings to buy cattle, trucks, or to set up shops. Fixed capital, like to buy tractors, threshers, combine machine, etc. Now let us switch over to the last topic of our chapter, that is non-farm activities of the Palampur. People of Palampur are, in the beginning we had discussed that all the people are not engaged in doing farming. Many people are doing activities which are non-farming activities, which are not related to farming. So such type of activities, some of the activities I have shown you, I will show you today. First is dairy. Some of the people in the villages, they are keeping some of the dairy animals and the dairy products, they are selling at a market and they are earning money. Like one example is written, dairy. Dairy is common activity in many families of Palampur. People feed their buffaloes on various kinds of grass and the jowar and bajra that grows during the rainy season. The milk is sold in Raiganj, the nearby large village. Two traders from the Shahpur town have set up collection cum chilling centers at the Raiganj, from where the milk is transported to far away towns and cities. One more activity I try to find out, and might be you are knowing, everybody is knowing, like transport. Nowadays it is a fast developing sector. There are variety of vehicles on the roads connecting Palampur to Raiganj, like rickshaw wala, tonga wala, jeep, tractor, truck drivers, and people driving the traditional bullock carts and bogi are the people in the transportation services. They ferry people and goods from one place to another, and in return they get paid for it. The number of people involved in transport has grown over the last several years. These are some of the non-farming activities. Some more examples are also there, like small-scale businesses are run by the people. Small-scale manufacturing work is also done by the people, like weaving basket, pot making, and many more. Some of the people are also engaged in doing other activities like shopkeeping. This is also one of the non-farming activities which the people used to practice in the villages. Now, this is the summary of the whole chapter which we discussed today. Now, I'm expecting that you have understood the whole chapter. Try to read the chapter from your book. Thank you.